We have an unidentified flying object.
Researcher on a mission with Dr. J. Andy Elias.
Welcome back to another episode of Dr. J Radio Live. I'm your host, of course, Dr. J, and this has been a long time in the making. And truly, in my heart, I believe that if things had gone differently about 27 years ago, we would honestly be living in a different world. With a popular vote of just under 52 million, this person could have led our nation and the world. And without further ado, let's bring on former presidential candidate as well as governor of Massachusetts, Michael Dukakis. Governor, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Nice to be with you.
It is an honest pleasure to have you. There is so many things going on in this world. I truly feel that if you won the presidency in 1988, things wouldn't have happened the way they did. I personally believe because every time there's a Republican in office, we end up more so in warfare than a Democrat. Before we get on to the current issues, what would you think you would have done differently in that term when we faced?
Well, I think you have to be fairly conservative in terms of what you think you can do. I mean, you've got 8 years. That's a you hope. I mean, if you can get yourself reelected, four at least, and you're not going to change the course of history. But I can assure you that we would have been working very hard to fight. Good and decent and affordable health care for all Americans, and especially working Americans and their families, starting in 1989. That is something that I felt very strongly. I was able to do it in Massachusetts and in my own state. And although my successor at the time did everything he could to try to slow it down and stop it, certainly gave the kind of momentum that then produced what, in point of fact, was a very good health care plan for Massachusetts. I am, as you know, a big, big fan of public transportation and high-speed rail. I mean, I think they're both essential, and we need them all across the country. And a lot of time and attention we've been focused on that. And finally, on the foreign policy side, John, as you know, I'm not a big fan of U.S. intervention here, there, and everywhere, all over the world. It isn't working. It hasn't worked. It keeps getting us into trouble. But I am a committed internationalist. I mean, you can't be the son of Greek immigrants and be an isolationist, right?
That's right.
I mean, we're brought up believing that we're part of a world, that we come from a very special part of the world, historically and otherwise. And but I'm a huge believer in building international institutions that set rules and enforce them in a way that makes it unnecessary for us to shoot each other. Because we're part of a world in which you have a set of rules, and they're enforceable. And so whether it's now or then, I mean, that would have been a very strong focus. And in this particular case, the guy that beat me, in fact, on the foreign policy side, although he was critical of some of the stuff that I was suggesting, turned out to be somebody who was a lot closer to me on the foreign policy side than his son, for obvious reasons. And I think, although I thought George H.W. Bush was kind of a lousy domestic president. I think his strength was foreign policy because he understood that you can't get things done in this world unless you do so working closely with other nations and with the international community. Unfortunately, that was not a lesson that his son had learned. And a lot of the chaos in the Middle East today is the direct result of not understanding the lessons that Bush 1 taught us. And with a lot of support from a lot of people, actually made happen.
I definitely have to agree with you. Being the world police is not the right thing to do. But at the same time, as you mentioned, being a global superpower, especially with the fall of the Soviet Union, we had to, as you mentioned, have foreign policy into place and essentially not so much intervene in the countries, but help them, maybe mediate between two countries that had wars going on, but not necessarily send our arms in there and launch, you know, bullets and bombs and start wars.
And, you know, we have done that. I mean, take the Western Hemisphere, our own hemisphere. which was nothing but a series of wars and coup d'etat and military dictatorships and the rest of it. And unfortunately, we contributed to that with what I thought was a badly advised Cuban policy, which has been a badly advised policy for 50 years, and which, to the credit of the president, we're finally changing. But we now have, in the Western Hemisphere, John, an organization, as you know, called the Organization of American States. It has a charter. It's kind of baby UN for the Western Hemisphere. And thanks largely to that, we've had a remarkably peaceful hemisphere, if you think back. And I think with the change in American foreign policy when it comes to Cuba, it will be even more so. And I think the Organization of American States is exactly the kind of thing we need in regions all over the world, under the aegis of the United Nations, but with a lot of hard work done on the part of all of the countries of the region. And that's the kind of thing I strongly believe in. And if we can do that, whether it's in Europe, including, by the way, Russia, or in the Far East and in the Pacific, where we have a serious danger, I think, of getting ourselves into a silly kind of Cold War there, or in our own hemisphere or elsewhere. That's the kind of foreign policy that I believe in. It's the kind of foreign policy I think the United States should be committed to. But it's a very different kind of foreign policy from one where we're running around with our heads cut off, trying to put out a fire here and a fire there, and ending up with invariably a mess on our hands, which is what we're seeing now in the Middle East.
You're absolutely right. I think that that's where we were heading with the Cold War. And essentially, right after the Iraq invasion 2003, beginning 2004, 2005, there were rumors that this would be the next Vietnam. And essentially, that's what it became to be. If you were in power today, if you were sitting in Barack Obama's position, what would you do to handle things differently to prevent us creating more fires as we're trying to put them out? Because it's very volatile in that area right now.
It's volatile, and to a very great extent, it was triggered by the invasion of Iraq, which I thought was one of the dumbest things we've ever done, and which has had untold consequences. On the other hand, to be perfectly bipartisan about this, when the president said at one point, Assad has got to go, I said to myself, John, if you know anything about the history of the Middle East, and I'm a big fan of history, as I mean, I think you've got to study history. You know, Greeks have an old saying, as you know, Pathima Mathima. It even rhymes. Things happen, you're supposed to learn from them, right?
That's right.
And I remember saying to Kitty at the time, if ever there was a candidate for non-intervention, it's Syria. If you know anything about the history of Syria, which, by the way, as you know, is a very rich history, one of the oldest Christian communities in the world, which will be wiped out by ISIS if they ever get a hold of them, and they're in the process of trying to do that now. We should have understood that 3 years ago. And whatever we thought of Assad, 3 million refugees and 250,000 dead people in Syria doesn't seem to me to be what the United States ought to be involved in. So a certain amount of restraint here, I think, is in order, even if we don't happen to like the particular government. And as you know, in point of fact, being a democratic government is not a prerequisite for American support. Otherwise, we wouldn't be so close to Saudi Arabia, among other places, right?
That's right.
So so I think the United States as a strong force for a world in which we have rules and we have ways to enforce them, but we also understand that this isn't going to happen overnight, and it will have to move at a pace which is consistent with what those particular countries desire, is the way to go. And a United States with that kind of attitude, I think, can do great good. And I'm very serious, John, when I say that I think we are on the threshold of what could be a world in which war is ruled out as a means for settling disputes between and among countries. We've never been this close. And I want my country to be the country that leads that effort.
I wholeheartedly agree with you. We recently spoke to a lieutenant colonel who wrote a book that's circulating among the Department of Defense called Mind War, and it's essentially to end physical warfare. And he goes into detail about how many trillions of dollars we spent in bombing bullets and killing people, which doesn't really solve anything. Every time someone dies, that creates another enemy, because if someone's father, someone's child, someone's brother, someone's sister, regardless of who it is, you have angry family members and friends who end up turning to hate, not just who killed them, but the country associated with them. And speaking of Syria, first of all, let me go back to what you said about history repeating itself. This is exactly why I think people needed to hear from you, and the same reason I bring anybody who has served in power and is essentially older than this generation, because you have lived it, you have seen it, and without your words telling the people right now, I think everything will be repeated, since we need to be looking at history. But back to Syria, a lot of people speculate that the reason Obama is asking for the funding is because this may end up leading into a war with Iran. Do you think that's possible?
Into a war with Iran?
Yes.
Well, here again, Iran today ought to be a friend and ally of the United States. Why isn't it? Because in 1953, the Eisenhower administration decided to overthrow the democratically elected government of Iran. And they did so. And what was the sin that triggered that? The fact that Iran wanted to own and operate its own oil industry rather than let Great Britain own and operate it. Now, you can understand why the country wanted control of its own oil industry. And yet, in the face of that, and under pressure from Winston Churchill, pressure which Harry Truman strongly resisted, the Eisenhower administration proceeded to use the CIA to overthrow the Iranian government and bring the Shah back. And everything that's happened since, and especially the attitude of some Iranians toward the United States, even though generally I think Iranians like the United States, has everything to do with that. Another example of American interventionism that has created a colossal mess. Now, the president, to his credit, and his secretary of state, and I'll take a little bit of credit for training him because he was my lieutenant governor before he came to the United States Senate. But I think the president and John Kerry have been working very hard to try to come up with an agreement which will put serious restrictions on Iran's ability to develop military uses of nuclear energy, and at the same time eliminate what could be a serious ongoing problem in the Middle East. And I commend them for that. I'm sorry the Prime Minister of Israel doesn't agree with me, but remember, I mean, Israel has got the bomb.
That's right.
Never admitted it, but they have it. So here again, we find ourselves in a very difficult situation, which I hope the President and the Secretary of State and, frankly, the Congress get us out of with a decent agreement here. But none of this would have happened if we hadn't decided that I guess we preferred a dictator in the form of the Shah to a democratic government, which was certainly not threatening us, and whose only goal was to finally nationalize the oil industry and let the Iranians run their own oil industry rather than a British imperial power, which is essentially what had been happening for years.
And it always sadly comes down to money. I'm going to ask you a quick question about interpretation, speaking of Eisenhower. As we all know, he was the supreme allied leader during
right.
World War II, led the Normandy invasion, and became president. And obviously being a general, he was a very military-style president going in. But leaving office in 1961, he made this very famous speech to warn us of the military-industrial complex.
Right.
How would you interpret that?
A very wise and experienced man giving us very wise and important advice as he left the presidency.
I definitely wholeheartedly agree. Now, going back to something we talked about earlier, something a little more lightheartedly, transportation. You see the transportation in Los Angeles and pretty much all of California, and for the nation for that matter, is really getting out of control. They can widen the 405 freeway, the 101, all they want, but it's never going to get better. But when you look at other states, cities that have subway systems, functioning public transportation, or countries in England, very few people even need cars, right, in London and New York. Don't you think, I know you advocated for this, but don't you think not only would we be better off, but it would save people money as well as headaches and not make people late for work?
Yes, and the people of Los Angeles agree with that, John, because remarkably, in the middle of a very severe recession, as you know, more than two-thirds of the voters in Los Angeles County voted to increase their taxes to pay for a modern rail-based transit system. That was really remarkable, you know. It really has happened. And now five different transit lines, some subway, some on the surface, are under construction in Los Angeles. And they're going to transform this city. Because once those lines are in place, people are going to be flocking into Los Angeles. They want to live here. They want to have the kind of rich cultural life that Los Angeles has now developed. They want to be close to the beach. They want to be reasonably close to the mountains. And you will see this city filling up with people and neighborhoods and activity, which is exactly what happens when you invest in rail-based transit. As only a guy from Boston knows, because my city was transformed by the kind of transit system that we were able to build and expand and rehabilitate. Now, at the same time, as anybody knows in California, you need something other than highways. You've just spent $1.2 billion on 10 miles of an HOV lane on a 405, right?
Yes.
And do you know what the results are?
None.
On average, cars are 4 minutes slower than they were before you built the thing.
So instead of solving the problem, it just adds to it. The problem.
Think if that money had gone into at least the beginning of a transit connection between Westwood and the Valley. What kind of impact would that have had on the 405?
Far more.
So I'm really very excited about this. You know, we've been out here for 20 years. I've taught at UCLA for 20 consecutive winter quarters. We love coming out here. We love this place. I love teaching these kids. And now, thanks to the people of Los Angeles, you're going to have yourselves a modern public transportation system. Now, what don't you have? You don't have an effective inner city system. I spoke to the San Diego City Club. It's kind of the Commonwealth Forum of San Diego. I do that every year. A few weeks ago, Kitty and I left Los Angeles at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. 3.75 hours later, we arrived in San Diego. In this study, at 1 in the afternoon, a high-speed train between Los Angeles and San Diego would get you down there in 55 minutes. Think about it.
People will be truly relieved when they don't have to drive an hour and a half to get 15, 20 miles.
No question. I mean, we were going nuts trying to make it to our destination in San Diego. Now, of course, if you build a high-speed rail system, and I think it's an absolute priority for this state, then you got to make sure when you get to the station in San Diego that there's a good public transportation system that connects directly with the railroad station and takes you to a destination. And if you go to Europe, that means if you come to Boston, that in fact is the case. I mean, you arrive at either North or South Station, and there's an excellent transit system which then takes you just about anywhere you want to go. There's no reason why California shouldn't have exactly that kind of system. But we're not going to get it if we're spending $300 billion on a supersonic bomber, whose purpose is a mystery to me, at least. That's the kind of investment we should be making in our country, in our economy, and in our people.
I'm glad you mentioned the inner city workings, because they absolutely have to be in place. Every stone needs to be left or turned, because if you have a rail that will take you to another city, yet there's no infrastructure in place to take you where you need to go within the city, what are you going to do? Rent a car and put you back in the same position as you were had you not taken the car to begin with? So you're absolutely right, and I wholeheartedly agree that we need to get to that level. But do you think it should be built the outside in or the inside out? Meaning, should we begin working within the cities to create local transportation and then go on to the statewide high-speed rail, or the other way around, connect all the major cities with this high-speed rail in California and then go into each city?
You got to do both, John. You got to do both. You've got to build the basic high-speed system that connects the northern and southern parts of the state. And that's finally underway. But at the same time, local communities, Los Angeles is doing this. San Francisco has done it. San Jose is doing it. Others ought to be doing this. Those local communities themselves, with some federal and state help, ought to be building those local transit systems, so when you arrive at the San Francisco Transbay Terminal or at Union Station, now connected, and it soon will be, with the entire transit system, thanks to this downtown connector that's getting underway. That's what you really need. And there's no reason why we shouldn't have both. I mean, how do these other countries do it? You know, you go to Europe, you go to Japan, now you go to China. How do they do it? It's not rocket science. And I think the state of California has the capacity and the will to do this, and the sooner the better, frankly.
I agree. Better late than never is definitely the key.
This city had the best streetcar system in America prior to World War II. You could go anywhere in those big red streetcars. But, you know, we were all going to drive, and we didn't have to worry about public transportation, and so the system deteriorated. Some of it was abandoned. Some of it was ripped up. And now it's going to cost hundreds of millions of dollars to replace that. But, okay, that was a mistake made in the past. The question is, what are we doing looking ahead? And I'm very impressed with this. Antonio Villaraigosa deserves enormous praise for pushing this when a lot of people were skeptics. Mayor Garcetti is strongly supportive of it. And obviously, the vast majority of people in this city are for it. Otherwise, they wouldn't have voted to increase their taxes to pay for it. So my hat's off to Los Angeles and Southern California for all of this.
You're absolutely right. It is about time. The voters definitely want it. The people definitely need it. This city, and compared to other cities or states, for that matter, the state of California, we have more cars per capita per individual than essentially necessary. People love their cars, but at the same time, had we had this transportation system into place, people wouldn't need 3-4 cars or whatever many they have per household.
And they love good transit. Take a look at the Blue Line, which connects, as you know, Los Angeles with Long Beach. The Blue Line is the most successful light rail system in the country. Did you know that? The most successful light rail system in the country. Wait for the Expo Line to be completed at the end of this year to connect downtown with Santa Monica. It's going to be hugely attractive. It's going to carry thousands of people. And more people are going to want to live along it and close to those stations so they can walk to the station and then get to work or get to wherever they're going. So let me tell you, it's going to be wonderful, and this city is going to be really transformed in the best kind of way. And so it's not just a question of this one or that one. The state, federal government ought to be working hard on an intercity high-speed rail system. Local communities should be working hard on their local public transportation system, so when you get to that train station, you can immediately walk across the platform and be there. By the way, I don't know whether you've been to Denver lately, but that's exactly what's happening in Denver, which looked a lot more like the old Los Angeles than anything else. They voted to raise their taxes. They're now investing that money in an excellent public transportation system, including a connector direct to the Denver airport. And the old Union Station, which when I first walked through it, when I went on the Amtrak board, was a real wreck, is an absolutely beautifully restored building. where all of these transit lines will converge. That's exactly what you need and what you want.
And this will not only help our economy ease people's stress, but there will be a renaissance in the city by providing people, like you said, access to get there. And the historical downtown Los Angeles will once again be thriving as it was 50, even maybe 100 years ago, as you mentioned, pre-World War II when we had the streetcar system.
And coming alive already. I'm looking out my office window at UCLA to the skyline of downtown Los Angeles. I mean, it's absolutely impressive. And by the way, I can see it. 15 years ago, I couldn't have seen it. It would have been covered with a blanket of brown smog, which also says something about what the city and the state are doing to deal with air pollution. So I'm very much an optimist about California and about Southern California, and especially the kinds of decisions that have been made recently, which are really going to turn this city and this region into very special places.
I definitely agree with that. I think not only will it be good for our economy, but as you mentioned, our ecology as well. The fact that we see the air we breathe is not something we should be proud about. I know that's a joke that everywhere people go, oh, I don't trust air, I don't breathe. That's harmful for you. So when the day we can look out the window and see the city and not see a giant cloud of smog and know people are less stressed because they're able to get to work on time and not spend – people – as you know this, they make their decisions of where to live and their jobs, where to work, based on traffic. That's pretty sad. If you're offered a good position at a company, you shouldn't have to turn it down because you have to factor in the amount of traffic.
Yep.
Now, let's take this to segue back to the healthcare. I definitely believe that a government such as ours, the United States of America, who is supposed to lead the world as an example, we're fell behind, essentially. I remember when I visited the UK as well as France, their healthcare system in place for all their citizens is really top of the notch, as well as no one really has to care for it and to pay for it out of their own pocket. Now, here, prior to Obamacare, my insurance rates, my health care was extremely phenomenally high. But at the same time, post-Obamacare, my benefits went down, yet my rates didn't change at all. I currently see this as, or a lot of people see it as currently flawed, but I think over a couple years it will fix itself. What would you do to iron out the details that are holding us back?
Well, look, the bill that I signed in Massachusetts essentially was a state version of the Nixon plan, which was a very good plan, by the way, and which has been in operation in the state of Hawaii since 1975. People don't think about that. I mean, Hawaii has had this since 1975. Hawaii has some of the best health outcomes in the country, and it pays for a very high-cost state some of the lowest health costs in the country. There are a lot of reasons for that. But there's no question, first, that the Affordable Care Act has kept health costs under control, which were skyrocketing prior to that time. And secondly, it's responsible for ensuring millions and millions of working Americans and their families, John. These folks aren't sitting around. They're not loafing. They're not public assistants. If you're not wealthy, you get Medi-Cal. These are working Americans and their families without a dime of health insurance. And, of course, when they get so sick that they can't stand up, they end up in the emergency room, and we're all paying for it and paying through the nose. We spend double per capita on health care than any of the other advanced industrialized nations in the world. They all have universal coverage, and we're still struggling to get there. That's thing in a nutshell. Now, let me just say this. If we don't take a poll tomorrow and say to the American people, should working Americans and their families have decent, affordable health care, what do you think the numbers would look like?
Not very
well,
good.
Well, over 90% of the American people say working Americans and their families should have decent, affordable health care. I don't think my party's done a very good job of delivering that message, of helping people understand that this is about working folks. Working folks and their families.
And that's exactly what I was going to make the point on. You mentioned it. You said the exact words, American working class families, the middle class. That is who's being truly affected. If you are in the poverty zone, yes, you get Medicare or Medi-Cal. But if you are doing making over six figures or fairly wealthy, you can afford great health insurance. As you mentioned, it is the people in the middle that, yes, that make up the majority of our population and yet have the lowest percentage of uninsured, at least prior to this enactment.
Not only that, it's a big boon to small businesses. You know, originally the fear was what? That this would hurt small businesses, they'd have to insure and so on. I had lunch today with a successful small businessman here in Los Angeles who employs about 50 people. He is saving, he told me, about $7,000 a month in health insurance premiums thanks to the Affordable Care Act. And he's not alone. So there are tremendous benefits here. And again, I think those of us who are strong supporters of the President's plan have not done a very good job of helping people to understand just how important it is and who is benefiting from it. Because they're precisely the folks that you're talking about. Middle income, low, moderate, working folks who obviously can't pay out of their pocket for 100% of what the insurance companies are charging. And I think, assuming the Supreme Court keeps its hands off this thing, and that's a big assumption, unfortunately, as you know, there's no reason why we shouldn't have virtually every American insured with decent, affordable health care.
Exactly. And it's pretty sad when a country has the people living in poverty essentially getting better health care than the people that are working class and contributing to the economy.
Isn't that crazy? I mean, it's not that we want poor people not to be provided with decent health care, but what about working folks? Average, middle-income working folks. I mean, what about them? What about the self-employed? What about this small business guy who employs 40 or 50 people and today is saving money while his employees are being provided good and decent health care? I mean, that's the message, it seems to me, that we've got to get out there. And in the meantime, I certainly hope that the Supreme Court will not gut the bill. There is absolutely no legal basis for this suit. I'm surprised they even took the case. And I hope and expect that the Affordable Care Act will be intact and moving ahead once that decision is over.
If they tried to end it right now, I think it'd be more catastrophic because you have so many people that have signed up now under the Affordable
Millions.
Health Care Act.
Millions.
What would you do? Just to cut them off?
That's a very good question. You've got a Congress that doesn't seem to be interested and has voted how many times to repeal the Affordable Care Act and has no clue as to what they would do as a substitute. None whatsoever, except to send people back to the emergency room, the most expensive and the most inefficient way to provide regular ongoing health care.
Speaking of this health care still at this moment, one thing that worries me is ever since it's been enacted, a poll not too long ago stated that a lot of the doctors would rather stop practicing or leave the country under this plan. And I know the personal impact I've seen is some doctors that used to take my insurance no longer take any insurance. And I walk into other doctors' offices and I've seen signs that says, we do not take Obamacare. This transition is a very scary one. What can we do as citizens and what can our government do to iron everything out?
This has nothing to do with Obamacare, John. This has everything to do with the most complicated, expensive, incomprehensible health insurance system in the world. 25 cents of every premium dollar these days goes for administrative overhead. Can you believe this? And ask doctors what it's like to try to work through this system. I can't speak for California, but I can tell you that in Boston, for example, the teaching hospital, which is the teaching hospital for Tufts Medical School, one of our great medical schools in the Boston area, and by the way, the place where our primary doctor out here in California got his medical degree, is the teaching hospital is a medium-sized hospital. It's the Tufts New England Medical Center with about 400 beds. John, how many people do you think they have on staff doing nothing but wrestling with and fighting with insurance companies. What do you think?
A ridiculously high number, I would presume.
500 salaried employees. All they do all day long is try to deal with this. I don't know of a doctor that doesn't have two or three people on staff doing nothing but arguing with insurance companies. Now, there's an answer to this. Simplify the system. Simplify the system. And we can do that. But state legislatures have to act on this. So, the Affordable Care Act does, in fact, have some provisions in it designed to help the states do that. But there's no reason why we have 15 or 20 or 25 different kinds of health insurance. It's ridiculous. You know, three basic policies, take your pick, same definitions, same billing codes, all that kind of stuff. We could save absolutely billions by doing that. And at the same time, it'd make it possible for our doctors to practice medicine instead of having to wrestle with insurance companies every day.
By having it so difficult, you're absolutely right. It's not only creating chaos, but it's scaring people. It's scaring doctors. And as you mentioned, you're absolutely right. People in doctor's office, their full-time job that I've seen is, you're right.
That's all they do. That's all they do all day long is argue with, negotiate with, debate with insurance companies. And I'm not blaming the insurance companies. What we ought to have is insurance regulators in this country. You've got an insurance commissioner. We have an insurance commissioner who have the authority to dramatically simplify the system, make it easier for people to get access, make it much easier for doctors to practice medicine instead of putting up with this stuff, and will save us absolutely billions of dollars. And the faster we can do that, the better, in my opinion.
I agree, and that actually brings the next topic, because saving billions of dollars is vital to our economy. We need to get to the point of saving trillions to end this deficit. But let's talk about the geopolitical world, or the geopolitical or geoeconomic situation right now, specifically our heritage, our country, or Greece, which is drastically changing right now. They've put on the table where they want Plan A to eliminate 50% of the debt to Germany, but they say there's no Plan B. What do you think, again, just as opinion, what do you think could happen and will happen?
Well, first, the Greeks have to do certain things. And you know that, and I know that. They've got to clean up corruption. They've got to go out and collect taxes owed, especially by the wealthy, who are notorious evaders. They've got to eliminate a lot of the feather bedding that goes on in the system. And I think the new government is committed to doing that. They've even been appointed a minister of corruption, as you know, who's one of the best people in the business in Greece, one of the best corruption fighters there is, as a new minister in the cabinet. But austerity never got any country out of a recession. I mean, that's just a historic fact. And to impose this kind of mindless austerity on the Greeks and the Greek economy, knowing makes no sense to me, they will never get out of this hole if that's what you insist that they do. And so the new government is not saying we won't pay. The new government is saying we've got to stretch out this debt burden. We've got to, we can't do it overnight. We can't do it just with a click of the fingers. And they're right. They're right. No matter how that debt accumulated, you cannot turn an economy around with those kinds of policies. We tried it once in 1929, right?
Yes.
When Herbert Hoover was the president. Pathima mathima, you know, you do it once, you ought to learn from that experience. And yet, frankly, the Republicans in Congress wanted that policy, which fortunately Obama and the Democratic Congress at the time refused to adopt. If we had done what they wanted us to do, John, we would be looking like Europe these days. We'd be looking like Europe these days. So enough of the austerity stuff. Insist that Greece govern itself well and honestly and efficiently. But for heaven's sakes, give them a little bit of breathing room. And that's really all the new government is asking, so that they can deal with these terrible problems of poverty and at the same time get their economy back on track.
There's a few points I want to make, and you've hit all of the major ones. First of all, the corruption is out of control in Greece. The unemployment is so high, 25% around the country, 50% among the youth, and then the debt itself, 175% of the GDP. As we talked about off air prior to today, we mentioned that what would a situation do with if someone owed money to their creditors, what would they do on that micro level? Well, you'd work it out. You wouldn't just say take it or leave it.
You'd go to the bank and you'd say, look, I'm hurting. Can we stretch it out? Can we just pay interest for some period of time? Are there ways that we can adjust this? And the vast majority of banks will do that. Now, if that's the case in the banking business, why can't the EU do that? Not only for Greece's sake, but for its own sake. Because as you know, Southern Europe has similar unemployment rates, and they're having problems. And they're being told that they've got to practice austerity. It's just a totally self-defeating philosophy. It will never work. It hasn't worked. It's not going to work.
To have such a situation in place where essentially the European banks don't want to work with a struggling country, there's no positive interest on any side. First of all, the Greeks won't benefit from it. All of Europe won't benefit. And the banks won't benefit from it if they're not going to get any of their money back. It behooves them to work with Greece and all other struggling countries.
No question.
Some rumors are circulating that if Greece leaves the EU, which a lot of people argue it was a big mistake to have joined the European Union in the first place, that they may join the BRICS nations, meaning Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. Do you think that's a possibility?
I hope not. I mean, why would you want to join another bloc of nations, two of whom at least are in big trouble, and others may be? I mean, the Russian economy is in tatters. Brazil is struggling these days. I mean, why would it benefit Greece to join that? Look, Greece's place is in Europe. Always has been. And there's no reason under the sun why it can't continue to be a very important part of the European Union. What the EU has got to do is start using its head, understanding that there's no way this debt can be paid off in the short run, and do what responsible and thoughtful bankers do, which is to work with Greece to work out a payment plan and a schedule that it can handle. Remember, Greece is not saying, as you know, John, that we will not pay anything on our debt. They're just saying, look, we can't pay what you folks are demanding. We'll pay somewhat less and we'll stretch it out longer. Why isn't that a perfectly reasonable solution?
It's a very reasonable solution, which is why it boggles my mind that the European Union or banks or the German banks don't want to work with them. And that's what scares me. It makes no sense.
But the Central European Bank finally is beginning to act. And remember, Ben Bernanke, as chairman of the Federal Reserve, played a hugely important role in our recovery. And he calls himself a Republican. But there are a lot of Republicans in the Congress who are very angry with him. I think the Fed is out of control, that they never should have done this. Well, where would the United States be today if it hadn't been for Bernanke and the Federal Reserve back when we were in the depths? Of course it made sense. And there's no reason why the European Central Bank shouldn't do exactly the same thing.
I, again, wholeheartedly agree with what you said. And now I'm going to shift this to our domestic issue in the sense that our gold standard, the fact that Nixon left the gold standard in the 70s, and of course we've seen inflation at a very high rate and other countries, some demanding their gold back. What do you think of leaving the gold standard? I know this is over a 40-plus-year-old question, but do you think that was a good decision on Nixon's part?
Sure, because if you stick with the gold standard, it makes it very difficult for you to stay flexible when it comes to dealing with economic problems. I mean, there's no magic in gold. What's important is that we learn lessons from the past. We understand that when times are tough, we stimulate the economy. When times are good, we slow it down. We know how to do that, and we use the tools that we have in our toolbox, which this president and the Congress, at least in 2009-2010, did, which is one of the reasons why we're coming back so strong. Now, of course, the closer we get to full employment, the better the jobs are going to be, the better the wages are going to be. That's already happening. We saw that in the case of the Walmart decision on what their minimum wage would be. I mean, that wasn't done just out of the goodness of their heart. It was done because the economy is getting better and stronger, the labor market is tightening, and people are no longer going to work for Walmart for $8.25 an hour.
One startling figure that I heard was that the CEOs of Walmart, or the CEO, by the time he goes to lunch, makes more money than a general employee at Walmart makes throughout the entire year. The gap between working citizens and their respective CEOs is very, very high, far different than what it used to be in the 70s and 80s and prior decades to that. Do you think it's getting out of control, as I do? And what can we do as citizens, and what can the government do to put a stop to this drastic difference between wages in the, within the same companies?
Well, the first thing you do on the low end is raise the minimum wage. A number of states, by the way, I think close to 30 have already done so. We ought to have an increase in the minimum wage, the federal minimum wage. You know, if the minimum wage today, John, had simply kept pace with inflation with the minimum wage in 1969, the minimum wage today would be $11 and some odd cents in the United States. Just to keep the 69 minimum wage paying and purchasing the same thing. I think the earned income tax credit can be extremely helpful. There's nothing like full employment, I can tell you, to drive wages up. And I hope and expect that we will see that as well. Now, what do you do with these monstrous, enormous salaries? Subject them to a pretty significant tax. And if you do, then we can take some of that at least and begin investing it in the country's economy, in the country's future. So I don't think there's any kind of mystery to this. We know what we should be doing. The issue is, will we do it?
That's the key, and I really hope we do get to that, because decades ago, following World War II and before that, anybody can have essentially any job and support a family. You could be the milkman, or you can be a clerk at a store. Now, you can be earning, you can come right out of college or graduate school and get a decent job with a salary of, say, $60,000 a year or so, but yet you still can't afford to live yourself paying student loans, let alone support a family. What happened? How did we get here?
Well, lots of reasons for it. There have been interesting changes in society. Corporate boards and CEOs seem to think that they're entitled to 300 or 400 or 500 times the average salary in their companies. You remember Plato's mean when it came to salaries? He said the highest paid employees should not be making more than 4 times the lowest paid employee. That was Plato in ancient Greece. What is it now? 400 times, 500 times, 600 times. Now, I don't think we need wage or salary control over corporate salaries. I mean, what we need are tax policies that will expect the wealthy to give significantly more back on a percentage basis than somebody making a modest wage. And I think most people agree with that.
And this having such a drastic difference is why there is hatred among employees for their respective employers. Whereas you mentioned, as Plato, he thousands of years ago made a very fascinating remark. 4 to 1 is a very viable ratio, because not only do you have the respect of the employees, you're not separating classes, essentially.
Right.
And therefore, you're not saying, I'm above you, and therefore, I deserve to come here in my limousine and have all this money.
Yep.
While you can work and get nothing, essentially.
And you know, we happen to have a Greek American in Massachusetts who runs a very large and successful supermarket chain, which was the subject of a family feud as to who would own it and who would get the profits from it. But Arthur Demoulas has done an incredible job, and his employees essentially said, we won't work unless this guy is our CEO. Now, why do they love him so much? Because he pays a decent wage? Because he encourages people to stay and go up the promotional ladder? Because he has profit sharing? John, profit sharing. Because he provides good benefits? And when push came to shove, those employees proved to be incredibly loyal to him. And it's one of the reasons he's now the CEO.
And profit sharing, I think, is a very viable option.
Sure.
Give employees incentive,
yep,
as well as the productivity among
no
them would skyrocket.
No, yep.
Now, I'm going to come full circle because we're nearing the end of the hour and going back to our famous saying, Pathima Mathima, and again, of history repeating itself. Had you been elected in 1988, sworn in 1989, you would have been right in the midst of the collapse of the Soviet Union, which some people argue was needed to keep the United States in check. There was a check and balance, essentially. We wouldn't go to war with certain countries because we knew that we would have to face them. But when they left, it left the United States to be in a position to become the world police. And as we argued earlier, the intervention that we've had and implemented is done nothing but harm. And it's created a lot of hatred among other countries and their citizens to us. I remember walking around the streets of Switzerland and they hated me because I was American. Of course, when they got to know me as a personal level, then they said, okay, we just don't like your president. And do you think that we need to be checked by another country, or will we essentially learn? I know this is pure speculation, but people would love to hear.
Well,
what you
I
guys.
Think Bush 1 had it right when he said we need a new world order. What was he talking about? He was talking about a world in which the international community working together set some rules for the conduct of nations, the United States and Russia and China as well as others, with the kind of institutions, either through the United Nations or these regional organizations that we now have, that could make sure that these issues were settled peacefully and effectively. That's what he meant, and I agree with him. I agree with him. It's one of the reasons why I thought on the foreign policy side he was such a good president. And that's the only way we're going to create the kind of world that you and I and our kids and grandkids and their kids can have, and in which they can live peacefully and constructively and live good lives. That's where the United States ought to be exercising its leadership.
It is exactly the everything that you said is why I wanted to speak to you so long and bring your message to the airwaves. I truly wish you were sitting in the White House right now. Is there a possibility we can get you there?
No.
Again, would you run again?
There are good people out there, and I had my shot, and unfortunately I didn't make it. But that doesn't mean that one can't try to play a constructive role in all of this, and I've tried to do that since I left the governor's office. First, by teaching young people both on the East Coast and the West Coast, and I love teaching. I love working with these young people. We're producing some great young people in this country, and they're going to be great public servants. And I think one of the things that guys like me should be doing is doing the best we can to help encourage them, inspire them, and train them. And secondly, to stay deeply and actively involved in national affairs, world affairs, and to do whatever I can do and others like me to make this a better world. And, God, I'm 81 years of age. I feel about 21. I'm married to the most attractive Medicare recipient in America, and she's 78. We're blessed with great kids and grandkids, and we're going to continue to do everything we can to try to make this a better world, and to get great satisfaction and fulfillment, John, from doing that. I mean, we've been lucky. You know, it's been a gift to be able to be deeply and actively involved in public life. And I really feel that very strongly, and so does Kitty. So we're going to continue to do that, continue to try to encourage younger folks to follow in that path. And I can't think of anything better that one can do, and we're going to continue to do it, both here at UCLA and back in Northeastern and Boston.
What would you say to anybody out there who is fairly young enough to where they haven't made up their mind of where they're going to go as far as careers or what they're going to do to contribute to our world, those who are considering the life of politics? Is there anything you should warn them or give them encouragement?
Well, I say a number of things. First, there is nothing more personally fulfilling or satisfying than being in a position where you can make a difference in the lives of your fellow citizens. And that's what politics at its best allows you to do. But secondly, plan to live moderately. On metron ariston, right?
Yes.
Nothing in excess, everything in moderation. Plan to live modestly and get your kicks from the great satisfaction that comes from being deeply and actively involved in your community, in your state, in your country, in the world. And I will tell you that on both coasts, I'm teaching terrific young people who want to do that. And I'm going to do everything I can to inspire them to do that, to see if I can help them develop the skills that make it possible for them to be effective in public life, and to encourage them every step of the way.
Living moderately, as you said, is a very key component, I believe, because you have to lead by example. If you don't show that aspect of you, then what message would you be sending to everybody? I don't think a very good one. Governor Dukakis, it has been an absolute honor. As you mentioned, you are teaching actively and shaping the young minds. Just by doing this interview, you will have shaped countless of minds out there. And for this, I honestly must thank you from the bottom of my heart. Ευχαριστώ, as we say in Greek, as you know. If you have any final words for anybody out there listening, what would you have to
just
say?
To say to them that this is one guy who was a son of immigrants, didn't have a famous name, certainly didn't have enormous wealth, and has been able to achieve a certain degree of success in politics as a state legislator, as a three-term governor of my state. Sorry I didn't make it to the White House, but that was a winnable race. I just didn't do a very good job of trying to win it. But having said that, I hope people understand that this is the most open political system in the world. You don't have to kiss anybody's ring. You don't have to buy a ticket of admission. Get out there and get involved, and you'll make a difference, and you'll have the great, great satisfaction of knowing that you're making a difference.
There you have it, folks. Everybody, listen to these key words from what I think is one of the most influential leaders we could have had in history and still have blessing us to this day. Governor Dukakis, it has been an honest pleasure to have you, and we hope to have you back.
Thanks
have
so
a
much,
great
John. Happy
Thank
to do
you
it.
So much.
Appreciate it.